Hi, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Aris Cohen. I'm with Mellanox Technology. Sorry to keeping you waiting for your beers and drinks. We'll try to be as swift as possible.
Hi, everyone. My name is Aran, CEO at Cloudigo. Me and Aris, today we want to present a different perspective how to implement network services and virtual network services in high-performance I/O environment. So we'll start just with virtual networking today. So when we look at virtual networking today, it's mostly been implemented using a software switch in the hypervisor. This software switch provide, software switch in the hypervisor. This software switch provides switching, but it provides much more. Most of the virtual switching provides some programmability inside them, OpenFlow, P4, and other. And we are able today to provide virtual services and advanced virtual services in the hypervisor using the virtual switch. But this is working very well and mature, but does it fit high-performance virtual networking? When we are talking about high-performance, we are talking about 25, 40, and even 100 gig networking. And the answer for that, not only by us, by others as well, that it doesn't fit. And to solve that, there's few existing solutions. One of them is OVS-TPDK. OVS-TPDK is the same as OVS, just instead of using data path in the kernel, it uses it in user space. It uses the DPDK as the I/O in poll mode, and you can put one CPU or more for the poll mode, polling the data. It provides higher performance, but still, it's mostly software. And you, as a cloud provider, would have to provide relatively high CPU footprint for the networking services. Another solution is VPP. VPP works on packet batches, process the packet on a graph of a pipeline. It provides more customization, higher performance, but it's mostly on how to optimize and to use, squeeze more from your CPU, mostly the x86. And again, relatively, you will use high footprint of your CPU to provide high performance networking when we're talking about 40 and 100 gig networking. Another solution is SRIOV. So what is SRIOV? SRIOV is a way for hardware vendor, NIC vendor, to be able to represent their NIC as multiple PCI devices. We call those PCI devices virtual function, and the VM can connect directly to the virtual function, bypass the hypervisor altogether, and connect to the embedded switch that is on the SRIOV NIC. The advantages are clear. We get line rate performance up to the PCI or to the rate of the SRIOV NIC. We have persistent scale in the number of VMs up to, again, to the performance of the NIC. And the disadvantages are that these VFs are statically allocated. Each time you want to allocate more, you need to restart all the other VFs. They don't provide full NIC configuration, so you need to rely on the PF, the physical function, on some of the configuration. This is another limit, and when you change it, you change all the others. Most of those NICs provide very limited switching when between the VFs on the same NIC. And the most problematic and the most the biggest problem in today's SRIOV solution is that they don't provide local virtual services because they bypass the hypervisor. And the hypervisor was the one that provided the virtual services and the switching, so we are not able to do that today. So if we look in virtual network services, what are the challenges? If we want to provide them in high-performance I/O, so we talked about software switching. It's working, it's working well, but as we'll show in the number later, it takes relatively high CPU footprint. On the other way, if we provide it in a centralized manner, then we have to move all the data, all the packets to this centralized location. And like illustrated in this slide, if we provide a VM and SRIOV connection, high performance of 25 gig or more, then the bottleneck became the network node, the virtual service itself. So even if the VM gets the performance, then the centralized location will be the problem. When we look at this problem, what we really want to be able to do is be able to apply the services, the network services, on the path of the data in a way that doesn't consume large amount of our CPU footprint. And when we look at this problem, we can look as an analogy to other area and that we think it's a bit similar and to see how it was solved in that area. And the area that I'm talking about is web services, web application. And if we look about web application evolution over time, it started with a couple application that was one application, then it moved to the multi-tier level, web app DB, and now there's a big effort to move into smaller element that can be managed separately, orchestrated separately, scale in and out very easily. And the latest trend is serverless, and what does it mean, serverless? So serverless basically means that you don't need a wrapper around your task just waiting to be executed. You let your cloud provider decide when to run the task. And the task runs upon an event, and the cloud provider will decide where is the best place to run that task. The most used example is when you copy images to your object store and you want to generate thumbnails. If you use the microservices or VM paradigm, you have to copy the data from the object store to the VM container, generate the thumbnails, and then move them back to the object store. You would have some process waiting in idle just for you to copy stuff, and you will copy data way and back, not in an optimized way. If the cloud provider is able to do that, then he can decide where is the best place to do that, and in order to avoid copies, and will generate the task only when it's needed. So is there a similarity to web services, to network services? We think there is. If we look in network services, it started as an appliance. This appliance was a monolithic appliance that included all the network services, depending on the appliance, of course, but it included in a coupled way everything. Then we moved this coupled solution into a VM. The work that is being done by us and by a lot of other companies is to take this coupled solution to split it into smaller elements that could be orchestrated in a microservice fashion. And we think with the latest trends starting today, that we see more and more network cards becoming smarter. We have a simple element in the network card that is doing tunneling, header manipulation, header rewrite, and errors we'll show in a minute. It's coming more and more that we'd have more and more computation power on the NIC themselves. With this trend, we feel that we can change a lot of paradigms that exist today and how you look in network services. And if we model them a little bit differently, we can do things that are impossible today. And we can even, if we look at it as the NIC becoming the centralized piece on all the system, we can create uniform fabrics that, and we can even start thinking about changing the way we connect things and topologies, and we'll show it in a minute. And I will let Erez talk.
Thank you, Eran. So Eran just mentioned about moving workload inside the NIC, which is smarter and has new capabilities than just sending and receiving packets. And today we're hearing more and more about smart NICs. So modern data centers are really about having higher requirements than previous systems. So modern system, modern data centers are looking for very fast network adapters. People are talking about 25 gig today as the standard instead of 10 gig. And the more we look in the not too far future, we're seeing systems that are going to run on 100 gig. And even this year, we'll start see NICs that running at 200 gig. So really, the amount of traffic that we can pass inside the data center is growing, and it's mostly because of the microservices and the east-west communication. Low latency is also critical. It's critical because we are looking to segment our workload in a different way. Microservices really bring us into distributed workloads, and in the distributed workload, latency play a very significant part. Transport offload is really important as well. Transport offload enable us not only to have a very thick pipe to pass the data, but also it provides us the efficiency in how do we pass this data in a proper manner. Kernel bypass or direct user space access, you're probably familiar with DPDK, is another way to achieve very low latency and flexibility on the data transfer. Advanced virtualization support, Iran mentioned SRIOV or single root IO virtualization of one is one of the options, but there are additional virtualization capabilities that modern data center require. Flow-based switch, so with SRIOV, most NICs provide some kind of switch inside the NIC, but we are in a modern world and we're looking at flow-based, much better granularity. And the last point is software programmability. We do want to have very flexible and programmable infrastructure. So you're starting to see more and more SmartNIC coming up in the industry today. And SmartNIC are not only one option. There's multiple options to have SmartNIC. The first is having still ASIC, silicon design that used to be the standard NIC, but it is much more enhanced and provide flexibility. And we believe that this is the main use case that people will go, because in the end of the day, ASIC provide the most efficient, cost-efficient, highest performance option. But there are some cases that the standard SmartNIC ASIC is not enough, and then you will see a solution like ASIC with an FPGA, which is a very strong trend in the industry today, adding an FPGA as bump on the wire to provide offload capability in hardware speeds. And lastly, the system on a chip, which is basically a NIC together with one or more CPUs, general purpose, can be ARM or can be something else, that provide even more flexibility, even though obviously power-wise and size and cost, they're a little bit more complex and more expensive. So all those three options are available today, and we believe that the ASIC approach will be probably the most dominant one in the industry going forward. From Mellanox perspective, Mellanox has our NIC family is called ConnectX. I want to introduce you to the ConnectX 5, which is the most latest device that we have in the in our portfolio today. ConnectX 5 is an ASIC-based smart NIC. This is a device that ships to many, many, many vertical. It is not only for telco or only for specific market. It will go into general purpose cloud. It will go into high performance computing. It will go into data centers running Oracle or Hadoop or what have you. And at the same time, because of the architecture is so flexible, it can be used as a very advanced NIC to telco or NFV. It features Gen 3 and Gen 4 PCI Express by 16, so it provides a very thick line of up to 200 gigabit per second of a single NIC, which basically spread into two ports, network ports, that each can run up to 100 gig. But it really supports all the other speeds as well, so it supports 10, 25, 40, 50, and 100 gigabit per second, so all the needed speeds are supported. It supports stateless offloads, which mean checksum, RSS, all the advanced kind of capabilities that you would expect to see, both in a standard packet type VLAN, as well as an encapsulated packet. So you know that in SDN, encapsulation is very important. And solutions like VXLAN, MPLS, NSH, and others are very common. And we do want to enable all those offloads in that space as well. It has very high DPDK performance, so about 133, actually, the newest number, which is almost line rate of 100 gigabit per second. It has very advanced SRIOV support with Harvard-based quality of service. It has accelerated switching and packet processing. I will touch on that in a minute, but this is a very advanced virtual embedded switch that runs on the NIC itself and provides us the ability to offload a lot of the services that Eran talked about earlier. And it supports remote direct memory access, or RDMA, which is a very advanced transport service, very common in storage, for example. So I mentioned earlier accelerated switching and packet processing, or ASAP Square Direct. This is really innovative technology that provides the NIC the ability to process packets in as a flow-based switch and provide very advanced capabilities. So the NIC itself contains an embedded switch. It's a real switch. It's a switch implemented in hardware, and it is a flow-based switch. A flow-based switch means that it can offload match action operation. So there is a classification that is done on the packet, per packet, and instead of do that in the virtual switch or anywhere else, we do that in the real hardware, so it's very fast and very efficient. And for every classification, there is an action that is associated with that. Action can be forward the packet to some port, drop the packet, encapsulate it, decapsulate it, do routing, do NAT. A lot of the services that you would expect to see from a virtual switch like OVS or other virtual switches. The hardware capabilities are there, but without an API to consume them, we can't really use it. So we have the capabilities for over 2 years, but only recently we got to the point where, together with the community, the Linux community, the open vSwitch community, DPDK communities, OpenStack community, we enabled a set of API and integration in the open source communities to take advantage of those low-level capabilities in the NIC. The main APIs to consume those services are Linux TC, traffic control, which is a set of tools in Linux, and DPDK itself. And if you look at the drawing on the, or the chart on the left-hand side, you can see one of the use cases that we already implemented, and I'll show you a little bit of the numbers that we measured already. And this is just an example of one use case. Later on, Eran will explain how we take this kind of high-level use case and break it into much more advanced services or serverless services. But this use case basically take OVS. In this drawing, it says virtual switch, but it is OVS, and offload the flows rules into the NIC embedded switch, where the virtual machine themselves connected with SRIOV. So what we get here is we basically get a complete SDN enforced traffic data plane, while the data plane itself is implemented in hardware. So you can imagine how the performance is far greater. To give you some sense of numbers, we have run a comparison against yet another high performance mode of operation, which is OVS over DPDK. OVS over DPDK, as you know, change OVS instead of being run both in the kernel and the user space. It moves all the elements into user space. And then use DPDK to access the NIC hardware, and by that provide a much higher performance. Just to give you a ballpark number, OVS, standard OVS, a kernel-based implementation, can do, you know, I don't know, 500,000, maybe 1,000,000 packet per second of 64 bytes in a very good day. Probably much less than that. OVS over DPDK provide much more. You know, in our measurement, it was close to 8 million for few flows. If you add more flows, it kind of drop to about 2 million packet per second, which is much more than, you know, the 500,000. but it is still not enough. Plus, DPDK consumes quite a lot of CPU cores that basically waste a lot of your resources to run your VNFs. When we use OVS offload, we basically run the entire data path in the NIC and provide the VM connectivity with SRIOV. And with that, we gain 2 points. First, performance is much, much higher. So if you see in the numbers there, for a few flows, we get about 30 million packets per second, and it will grow even more with ConnectX5. And for a large amount of flows, we're kind of leveling around 15 million packets per second with encapsulation and decapsulation. And the other benefit is that we don't use any CPU cores, so you actually can spin much more VMs or much more application, and by that improve the overall efficiency of the system.
So CloudEgo and Mellanox, we partnered together to provide in the base offering the virtual services available today in Neutron, in OpenStack, for SRIOV devices. And what you can see on the right is a tenant virtual topology that has two networks connected with a virtual router, load balancer on two of the VM security groups, that is a stateful firewall, and virtual networking, and we want to be able to implement it in a physical deployment that we see on the left that is actually distributed. So we don't have a network node, we don't have a central place that does the services. And what you can see on the compute node, we have the CloudEgo engine. The CloudEgo engine is the engine that make it possible and orchestrate all of that using all the newest capabilities that Eric said of the ConnectX 5. So before we deep dive into the CloudEgo engine, a few things that we did a bit differently. So we took the network service and we split it into the smallest possible element. And then when we talked with hardware vendor, they are saying offload everything to the hardware. When you talk with software vendor, they say do it everything in software. But in reality, there are things that are better done in software and that can only be done in software in some cases. It's stateful operation, a complex operation and calculation, and areas that you need fast innovation cycles. And there are areas, and actually you want most of the packet to be processed by the hardware, where you do repetitive work, header manipulation, and more and other work. So what we are trying to provide is an hybrid solution. An hybrid solution that knows in your pipeline that you spread it into the smallest element, which element will be run in hardware and which element will run in software. And when you think about this problem, most of the use case that you provide, you just say, okay, let's take tunneling, see how I can offload it. Let's take routing, see how I can offload it. But if you look at OpenStack and what we saw, it's much more complex. You have a pipeline that includes virtual routing, security group, tunnel encapsulation, and in some cases, load balancing. You need to create this pipeline and think where to put each element of this pipeline in order to do it right. So it becomes an orchestration problem, and a big orchestration problem, where to place this element. And the unique feature of our engine that is not fixed. Most of the system just use caching mechanism. Decide, okay, this was recently used, I will use the other one, and just place in the hardware. But our solution takes into account all the pipeline and the traffic patterns that currently exist, and it can change. Models that were in hardware can switch to software and vice versa. And the engine for the NICs it supports, and currently we support a list of NICs, including the ConnectX 5 and 4. We know in very good, what's the advantages of the NIC, what are the benefits, which feature it has, and what's the limitation. And every hardware has its limitation. It can be the number of flow or any other things. So we need know to place it in the right place and learn depending on the traffic pattern and to know to be adaptive. So if we deep dive into the engine, you can see that you can connect VMs directly to SRIOV virtual function, or you can connect VM through the CloudEgo software engine, or connect containers via zero copy kernel model that we provide in a very efficient way. The CloudEgo programmable engine provides minimal latency and very, very small latency. And you can use our model, or you can include your own model in a very, very simple way to program and include to the system and program this model in a regular programming language. And we know to take the services and to split them, as we said earlier, take services like NAT, firewall, load balancer, routing, and split it into a small elements, and then put part of it in the NIC and part of it above in our engine. So if we go back to the scenario that we discussed earlier, we want to implement this virtual topology. So how do we do it? The CloudEgo engine knows to orchestrate the flows that only the flows that need software processing will go to the CloudEgo engine. And in a way that actually most of the traffic is flowing in the NIC, but we are able to provide advanced services, stateful, and everything that needs to be done in software can be done in software. And our engine is very optimized in software. It can run the same and even higher performance than the existing project that we showed earlier. But the main idea is to use existing hardware that is not used today. Some deployment that we saw, they have advanced NIC, and they are not using a lot of the feature of the NICs because it's very complex, it's very complicated to do. So to give you some number, we did a test scenario that provide encapsulation, virtual routing, security group. And if we look in OVS-TBDK, the paradigm of software switching, and we have here very optimistic numbers saying 8 gigabits for one core to provide a virtual routing, stateful security group, and encapsulation for a large number of flows. And if we want to provide 100 gig, we would have to use at least 12 cores in the solution just for the virtual networking. In this use case, we have a two-socket machine with total of 28 cores. So you can see the footprint for just providing the virtual services is huge, and you have less CPUs left for the user workload. In our solution, in CloudEgo, you can use one core for the virtual services, and you get left 27 cores for the user workload. This is more than 90% CPU saving and increase your ROI as a cloud provider because you can use it for VMs. And here the assumption is 4 VMs in each core. And another interesting thing is that OVS minimal latency is 33 microseconds. And 33 microseconds is just when it's doing forwarding, no advanced processing. In the CloudEgo system, because we know to pass most of the traffic inside the hardware and to use the capabilities and use the smart NIC embedded switching, it's actually close to zero, and we neglected the NIC latency here just for the calculation because in both you have the same latency. So we improved the density almost by 200%. We save CPU saving by 90%, and then we almost eliminate latency for the virtual services. So this was the base offering, but when you provide the, actually the biggest challenge is when you come and do deployment of this high performance solution. And especially in a telco NFV, connecting it to the access is a very complex thing. And usually you need a lot of customization. Our engine knows to use embedded features that are in the connectics and are not currently exposed via the API, like QNQ, PPPoE, and provide those features like the niche protocol, let's call it, that are not exposed. And we know to make it easy for the integration and provide them. So, and if you look on the VCPE use cases, a telco provider that wants to connect a VNFs that provide the VCPE would have to do QNQ load balancing or tunneling encapsulation to the end device. We, with the engine, will be able to provide, to offload most of it to the NIC and make it transparent for the integrator, almost transparent. And if you need special customization, it's possible using this solution. This is it, unless you have any questions, we will be happy to answer, yes? Excuse me?
You have integration before switch?
I'm sorry.
Hello.
Hello.
Did you have some integration to before switch?
We actually do not. This is a different solution than P4. P4 mostly give you the ability to have a dynamic header match and action. Here we are providing it in a pipeline, in a programmable pipeline. So it's a different solution from P4. Other, yes? On the hardware, you mean, the flows on the hardware? Yes, so we provide, in the engine, we both provide statistic counters, information about packets and statistic about what passed in each module and what we have in the hardware, meaning depend on the smart NIC capability to provide us the counter in the information, but all the counters that are provided by the hardware are exposed. If on the hardware, of course, if you can monitor the flows,
manipulate.
So a CloudIGO is like an abstraction layer that give you the service and knows to do part of it in software in hardware. I don't completely understand your question. If you're talking about manipulating them directly, then you can cause problem. But you, of course, can change the service and what you define via CloudIGO. And CloudIGO engines knows to manipulate in dynamically and change. Flows that were in the hardware knows to go to the software and vice versa. Are there other questions?
Dear time. Thank you. Have you seen any it seems to me that would be awfully appealing to almost any data center today to look seriously at this. Have you had much interest in it at this stage?
Yes, we are. I cannot disclose much about this, but We have a lot of interest. We are actually in a POC state for
Very
this
good.
Use case.
So just one other thing to that, to the POC. It's interesting because you're adding a kind of a turbo boost, right, to the switching, and you could find yourself in a situation where you got a rolling upgrade coming through, and somebody has not accounted for some component here, bypassing it, and consequently, all of a sudden, the performance plummeting, and the system effectively having to be rolled back in order to accommodate former service loads.
Okay, so because when you think about it, and it depends. If you have the same NIC on your cluster, What we provide is a way to do some rolling up the upgrades. Like you can test your upgrade on only 10% of the flows and then go on. But so we do that not only to provide to solve the problem that you described, but we see a need for fast innovation cycles today in the fabrics. And without deploying things that can get things broken, you won't get it. And we provide the ability to test it in a very small percentage on your flow and then take it down or increase it.
I guess I'll ask, how close are you getting to the kind of the ASIC speeds? Are you within an order of magnitude of something you would get on a Juniper core switch? Will we get, I guess I'm just wondering, you know, how much longer do they have a sort of a monopoly on that really, on the high speed stuff?
Currently on the CPU processing, to pass to the CPU directly, it's actually the PCI limit today. But I think Mellanox is working on the next generation PCI that will solve it. But we're seeing numbers, if you look in numbers of things that are possible only on software, without the hardware acceleration, it's amazing numbers today. And we from our experience, we see that all the existing software layer are becoming more and more mature and be able to provide advanced networking in high speed.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Beer party time.
Okay, thank you very much.